أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونستعين به ونتوكل عليه والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق وخاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين سيدنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين قال الله العظيم في كتابه الكريم وهو أحسن القائلين وأصدق الصادقين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا وقودها الناس والحجارة آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم for the purification of the souls, the enlightenment of the hearts, the acceptance of the deeds and for the hastening of the reappearance of the awaited Savior. عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف, enlighten your souls, purify your hearts and the atmosphere with the recitation of salawat upon Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Respected elders, sisters and brothers, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. This is a question that is asked by children to parents in some occasions. It's an area that has occupied the minds of philosophers, theologians, as well as other thinkers, but it's also a key element within the teachings of the religion of Islam, the establishment of monotheism, and the correct way of parenting. Who made God? Is a question that sometimes parents are faced with by their own children, or teachers at madrasa are questioned at certain occasions. The recognition emerges, and that is when it comes to a child throughout their early stages, they come forward with some tricky questions sometimes. They ask questions that could be awkward or difficult to answer, placing the mother or a father in a more difficult position than they would like to be. Without a shadow of a doubt, in the world today, in different communities, you speak to parents. Parents will tell you and I of the challenge that many of them are facing in this journey of parenthood, in the idea that this spectacular role that mothers and fathers have, especially those of the believers, is today being placed onto the spotlight. There are those who are concerned and worried about the future of their children, concerned because of the bombardment of thoughts and ideologies and movements. For example, in the Muslim world and in the Western world, there are those who worry about, for example, the lack of connection of their children, their daughters and their sons, with the religion of Islam. There are those who worry about friends and their influence upon their own children. And therefore, parenting, arguably, in this day and age, is a major challenge, but one that, without a shadow of a doubt, parents should embrace and, dare I say, enjoy, in the recognition that there is much reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants to those parents, the mothers and the fathers, that embrace these challenges and begin to look at modern ways in which they can enhance parenthood and establish their duties. Because I tell you, sometimes you hear some stories which are true, but quite strange. In India, there was a young man who took his parents to court. Why? He said, they did not ask for my permission when they brought me into this world, and therefore, I must sue them. I tell you, this person is not as bad as the individual in Nebraska in the 1970s, famously in America. He said, I must sue God the Almighty because he's putting me through much difficulty in life. And therefore, he must be what? Put to trial. The court was dismissed because the person or the being that is being accused cannot be found and does not have an address. In the recognition that today one of the difficulties that parents face are questions. Not only questions regarding faith, by the way. Questions regarding, for example, how babies are made from young children. Question regarding relationships. Question regarding politics and the environment. We recognize that questions play an integral role in the lives of children. And many of us see them innocently presenting these questions. I tell you, sometimes you face these questions and you wonder, how are you able to answer? I remember a few months ago, I took my six-year-old daughter to a funeral where I was conducting the Salatul Mayyit and the funeral rites. She observed for the first time in her life. Then in the car, she asked me, why is the person who has left this world covered in white cloth? Why do you have to wash his body? Why do you place this body inside what? The earth. These are questions that may be strange for you and I, but children are inquisitive. They wish to find out, isn't it? Without a shadow of a doubt. That's why I remember reading that once a child in church was taking for the first time to see a wedding. He looked at the bride who was approaching and entering the church. He asked his mother, why is the bride wearing white? His mother told him, white is the color of happiness, is the color of joy. He then immediately saw the groom wearing black and asked them, why is the groom wearing black? In the recognition that these questions require a certain type of thinking, a way to address. The independent newspaper in the United Kingdom in 2017 came forward with a study. It says on average, a parent is asked, both parents are asked 73 questions a day by their children. How many? 73 questions. In the recognition that this is not a small area of our lives, it's not something necessarily to take for granted. And it is an important segment of parenting and dealing with the future generation. Why? Because the answers we give, the way we respond, the communication between the parents and the children plays a major factor in the way that they understand aspects, especially when it comes to faith. Because I tell you, there are children who ask, does God eat or drink? Does he get married? Where is he now? For example, these are, despite you and I as adults, for example, dismissing these questions, important for a child. Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Famously says, the heart of a child is like an uncultivated piece of land. Whatever you place in it, it will grow, isn't it? Therefore, when you and I are approached by an individual who is a child and asks, who created God? Who made God? Yes, imagine now you're sitting here and somebody asks you this question. What would be your response? How will we approach this question in as far as our children are concerned? I would like to look at this area by answering and divulging into the following questions. Number one, what is the usual age range in which children ask these questions? Number two, what is the normal or incorrect way in which parents respond? There are five incorrect ways that people utilize when it comes to conversing and discussing this area or any other area with their children. Number three, how do we answer this question? Who made God? Is there an answer to it as adults? And how do we indeed put this towards the children in a way that they can understand? And number four, how did the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam deal with their children? How did they communicate with their children? How did they answer the questions of their children? Including Sayyidatul Nisa, Fatima al-Zahra al-Batul, salawatullahi wa salamu alayha. But before looking at these questions, there is a need for you and I to understand that when it comes to the school of Ahlul Bayt, it's the school of embracing and encouraging the what? The presentation of questions. Our motto is the Quran and its invitation to people in the incident of Mubahala. And that is what? فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ. Come, ask the question, isn't it? That's why, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless those parents who have truly understood their responsibility in ensuring that the concepts that the school of Ahlul Bayt presents, such as wilaya, are deeply enriched into the hearts of their children. And I remember reading the story of a young boy at the school in a country in the Middle East that is clearly anti-Shia. There is a rise of Shia phobia in that country. He was constantly taught at school that there was no successor chosen by the Prophet before he left this world. He was taught that the people chose the Khalifa after the Holy Prophet. When he came back home, his parents would correct this, but would ensure that he understood it in the right way. That's why one day in class, his teacher chose him to look after the class in the few moments that the teacher leaves to do some job. This is normal in some settings at schools and educational establishments. He was in charge of the class to ensure that everything runs smoothly, that nobody what misbehaves. After a few minutes, the teacher returned and asked him to sit down. Before he sat down, this clever young boy, schooled what in a protective way, right manner from his parents, he looked at his teacher and said, I have a question. I said, what is your question? He said, you left the classroom for 5 minutes and you ensured that I stay looking after the class so that it does not turn into chaos. How can the Prophet of God leave this world and abandon the religion of Islam without appointing a successor? The teacher looked at him, said, who's taught you this? How dare you question what I teach you? You are suspended from school. He sent him to the head teacher. The head teacher looks at him and says, tomorrow you're going to have to bring your wali, your guardian, whoever that person is. Yes, your wali, and we will issue the papers necessary so that you are suspended from the school. He says, very well. Next day, this young boy knocks on the door. The head teacher says, come in. He enters by himself. He says, did you bring your wali? He said, yes. Where is he or she? He says, outside. Let them come in. He calls. And the person who enters is a friend, a young boy enters. The head teacher, now angry, visibly shaken, stands up and says, yesterday I told you, bring your wali. Yes, you bring me a friend. He said to him, dear sir, you and this school has taught us that the word wali in the incident of Ghadir means friend. Therefore, I brought my friend with me. He said, how dare you? I told you wali, meaning somebody in charge. He said, that is why we, the Shia, say when the Prophet said, man kuntu mawla, means whomsoever I am in charge of, then Ali is in charge of. Don't tell me wali means friend, where now you're telling me bring someone who's in charge of you. In the recognition that sometimes when we use the right, correct way with our children, they are able to grasp and understand these concepts and present them in the best possible way. There is a Swiss professor who died in 1980. His name is Jean Piaget. This particular individual, he was a person who studied human development as far as cognitive skills and intelligence is concerned, and he was a psychologist. He studied the stages of human development. When it comes to asking the question, our children, when they ask these delicate, sensitive, sometimes tricky questions, where and when do they start asking these questions? Because I tell you, sometimes when you see a young boy or a girl who's 4 or 5, ask these questions, you dismiss them. So where did you get this idea from? Immediately you become more protective and you say, whoa, 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 this is not something you should be asking now. Yes? Does science support this or not? This particular scholar, he came forward and had a theory about the stages of human development. He said, a child goes through four stages. Please understand this. So next time a child asks you a question, you recognize what? The age that they are asking is not necessarily young, yes? He says there are four stages. Two of them is of concern for us. The first stage is called the sensorimeter phase. This is from 0 to 2. When this young boy or girl begins to explore this world through touching, through playing, yes, through the senses, there is the physical exploration of the world around them. This is called the sensorimeter stage. Then the next stage is from 2 to 7, and it's called the pre-operational stage. Now they play more, now they pretend more, now they are able to speak and communicate the thoughts that they had, yes? He and others who later developed his work came to the conclusion that when it comes to the questions in the mind of a child, it starts at which stage, do you think? We may think it starts at the second stage. He says, no, it starts at the first stage, the sensorimeter stage. Yes, the questions are there, but the child is unable to communicate these questions. The next phase, yes, the next phase, which is the pre-operational stage in their human cognitive development, is when they are able to express these questions. Therefore, studies have shown that the questions of children peak between 4 and 6 years of age. That is the age in which they crave information. They are learning. Yes, they want to explore. Therefore, innocently or sometimes deliberately, they ask. Can you imagine that a child that age is craving and wants to ask? Parents, when they see children at this age, sometimes think of the worst and refuse to answer. And then we have this unfortunate gap, vacuum, where the children is wanting information, not getting it from their parents. Later on, studies have shown between 10 and 14, these boys and girls no longer ask. They start forming their own ideas, building their own concepts as much as they were asking before. They are what? Reducing the number of questions that they would necessarily ask. Therefore, this phase is of the utmost importance. That is why some of our scholars have said this phase of childhood is similar to philosophers. Philosophers, what do? They ask and they wonder and they ponder and they begin to look at the roots of everything, isn't it? I remember reading a story of a parent, of a father, sitting with his son. His son was studying philosophy at college or university. So his father said to him, can you tell me what is philosophy? You want to be a philosopher? What is this whole thing about philosophy? He said to him, father, you know, in front of us, there is a plate with rice and one chicken. I can, as a philosopher, prove to you that there are two chickens here, not one. His father looked at him, smiled, placed that one chicken on his plate and said, very well, you can continue to prove and the next chicken is for you. Continue. Yes? In the recognition that what? A child acts like a philosopher in wanting to investigate and delve and become more what? Acquainted with what is around them. Similarly, what do we find? We find the recognition that today we are encouraged to appreciate that children at that age, if that need is not fulfilled, they turn to whom? They turn to other means. They turn to other people. They turn to the internet. They turn to, unfortunately, sources in which this is not necessarily fulfilled in the right way. Now, the question is, how do parents normally react to a question like this? Who made God? A child asks. There are five, please pay attention to this, five incorrect methods of dealing with this question. And other similar questions, whether related to faith or other inquisitive areas of our children. Yes? Five ways in which, as parents, we are not supposed to what reply or deal with a scenario like this. The first is dismissal. Dismissal means what? Means that we ignore the question, or we say, you know, this is not for you. You are not supposed to be necessarily asking this question. Yes. Why? Because we recognize that this question may be above what they are thinking. And therefore, we dismiss the need to ask this question. As a result, the children will turn to other sources, no doubt. The second way in which, unfortunately, some parents deal with a question like this is that they ridicule, they joke about this, they mock in front of the child. Others will be watching. Or even the child by himself or herself, they mock this particular question. Say, are you really serious? What are you asking this question for? Yes? This doesn't make any sense. What do you mean, who made God? This doesn't make any sense. And then they laugh about it. What does this do to the child? Destroy their self-esteem, their self-worth. The child will now begin to formulate this idea that, you know what? I'm not somebody who is worth asking this question, because my father or mother immediately joked about it. Yes? They ridiculed it. They mocked it. And therefore, I should not ask any of these questions anymore. Because I tell you, Allah, today, there is a silence movement going on in universities and other places. This atheism that is breeding amongst some of our community members around the world, from the followers of the school of Ahlul Bayt. Yes? These questions are not being answered when they're young. And do you know why they're not being answered? Because you speak to your parents and say, what happened to M&Ms? You say to them, what? They say, M&Ms. We are leaving everything in the hands of M&M. Not the very nice chocolate that we eat. Member and madrasa. They are the source of information. They should be answering these questions. I tell you, when that boy 16, when that 18-year-old girl goes to university, and what? Those atheists and agnostics are posing these questions. Why evil exists? Why is God not stopping this? Where is God? Who made God? They begin to doubt. They begin to what? Have weakness in their iman. Yes. So the second area is the ridiculing these questions. The third is deterrence. Deterrence means what? You say, astaghfirullah. This is shaitan playing in your mind. Have you heard this? When somebody asks a question you don't like, you immediately switch and somehow begin to make them doubt their faith or their question, to somehow blame the enemy, the arch enemy, that being the shaitan. The number four area is what? Is when you start accusing them or judging them of having weak iman or faith. A child comes forward and asks this question, you begin to say, that means you're becoming a less of a Muslim. This question indicates that you are not a very strong believer, because you should not be asking these questions, the parent would say. I tell you, there is a professor called Professor Jaffari. He embraced Islam in the 1980s. He had many questions, yes. He went to a particular country in the Middle East that teaches and espouses extremist Islam, yes. He went to that particular country, he had questions. They told him, don't ask. Because if you ask, that means you are a weak Muslim. You do not have faith. You do not have iman. You do not have conviction in Allah. He came back to the United States. He wrote a book. Even angels ask. He wrote on it, if the angels asked Allah, why is it that you are creating this creation that is causing bloodshed? Why are you not answering my questions? Allah allowed the angels to ask. That's why one of our scholars says that, you know, when I was also studying, he says, I was studying in the Hawza, I went to one of my teachers and I had these doubts. I had these questions. The teacher said to me, shaitan has taken you over. Go home and read Quran. Take the jinn and the shaitan out of you. He said, I was wondering, why are my questions not being answered? We must not be of those who immediately judge an individual who has a question. But just because they have a question, we start labeling them. Start thinking that they have left the faith. They have left the school of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salam. And the fifth way in which, unfortunately, some parents deal with tough, difficult questions from their children is what? is when they give them wrong answers. Or they make up an answer. Or they Google an answer very quickly and just give it to them. There was an individual by the name of Mustafa Mahmoud. He is an Egyptian scholar. Yes. He wrote a book, Rahlatun min al-Imani ila al-Ilhad, My Journey from Faith to Atheism. He became an atheist after being a Muslim. He said, do you know why I became an atheist? He said, in my village, there was a scholar that people respected. Once I came to him, I said to him, Ya Sheikh, I have a problem in my house. So what is your problem? He said, I have many insects. I want you to give me a ta'weez or a dua or something that helps to defeat these insects. He said, very well, recite the following and do the next few things and the insects will go away. He said, I took what he said. That night I recited, I woke up in the morning, my house had even more insects. He said, I went back to him and said, if you can't remove and take away insects from me, how can you remove shaitan and sins from me? So I left Islam. Unfortunately, sometimes we give answers that may weaken the faith of some individuals, including our children. We don't think and ponder. I remember one individual said to me that a non-Muslim friend asked me about Ashura, asked me about Sayyid al-Shuhada, about Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. He said to me, what is the big deal about Karbala and the 10th of Muharram? What was wrong with this individual ruling at that time? He said, you know, a member of our community went and said to him, the problem with Yazid was that he used to drink alcohol a lot and he was a womanizer. He said, that non-Muslim said, that's not really a major issue because I do that too. Sometimes the answer that we give to a question may what? May take an individual way further, isn't it? Make it even worse. Therefore, our sixth holy Imam, Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, tells us, converse with your children and answer their question in a hadith, lest if you don't do so, they will have a communication with those who have transgressed and disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this brings us to the correct way of dealing with these questions. What is the most important factor in parenting when it comes to dealing with tough questions that our children ask, including this? That is establishing the parent-child connectedness. Please understand this. Over 600 studies have shown that parent-child connectedness is the super protective factor when it comes to establishing a healthy childhood, when it comes to establishing a progressive developed child. What do we mean? In the recognition that if a parent invests time to connect with their child from a young age, connect means what? Spends time with them, pays attention to them, answers their question, does not dismiss them, yes, from a young age, that will ensure that this child will always go back to the parent later on in life when they're having difficulty. Look at the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us a story of many of the parent-child relationships. Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Yaqub alayhi salam, Luqman and others. The way they communicated with their children. Ibrahim alayhi salam would seek consultation with his son Ismail. Ya bunayya inni ara fil manami anni adbahuk fandur madha tara. Oh my dear son, I have seen in my dream that I must slaughter you. What do you think? Ibrahim is consulting his son on a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you think Ibrahim knows that this dream is a command from Allah? Definitely. Yet despite this, he does not come and say to his son, you must do what I am about to tell you. What do you think, my dear son? Yes, there is this parent-child connectedness that exists between Yaqub and Yusuf, between Luqman and his son, between Ibrahim and his son Ismail. Yes? And you find this in Nahj al-Balagha between Amir al-Mu'mineen and his sons. The way he addresses them, the way he leaves his instructions for them, oozes with love, oozes with compassion, oozes with investment into their own lives. Yes? This is key. This is absolutely essential when it comes to what? When it comes to this. Because I tell you, the problem that we face today, and one of the ways in which you can somehow figure out, there are amongst us, and those watching, those who are parents, who alhamdulillah have their sons or daughters married already. This is good advice for what? Your grandchildren. There are those who are having or have young children now. This is great advice as you are parenting them. There are those who are thinking about having children. There are those who will get married. This is universal. It affects each and every one of us. A major indicator of whether a parent connects with their child is the following. When you're sitting alone with your son or daughter, how comfortable are you with them? Please understand this. Do you feel it's awkward? Can you have a conversation with them? Are you open and are they open with you? Sometimes mu'mineen come to us, they say, my 16-year-old daughter is not listening. She's taking off the hijab. Please, Mawlana, where is your magic wand? The ship has sailed. If you did not invest when that child was young, if you did not establish the connection when they are what, 3, 4, 5, 6, up until 12, it is what, an uphill struggle. And that's why it's worth it, isn't it? There are some tips that we are told how we can approach these questions. Number one, we have to show that we care. When a question like this is presented, you and I as parents, we have to demonstrate that we care about this particular area. Number two, thank the child. Thank you for your question. Yes, makes the child feel appreciated. Makes them, you know, feel that the parent understands their struggle or their thoughts in their minds. Number three, of great importance, educate yourself. And be humble. There are some parents who say, I cannot say to my child, I don't know the answer. Because that weakens my position before my child. But you may damage more if you make up the answer. Because I tell you today, there are those who have confused many aspects regarding Islam and culture. And they teach their children culture, making their children believe that it's part of Sharia law, for example. What happens in marriages, for instance? Yes. What happens when it comes to relationships and the way you interact with others? In certain communities, I see cousins embracing and hugging. When I ask them, is this allowed? They say, yes, we have been brought up with this because she's my cousin. What I and her have virtually lived and been brought up in the same household. Don't worry, Mawlana, nothing will happen between us. Yes? So sometimes parents are guilty of conflating culture with what? With religion. So therefore, education of one's understanding of faith is of the utmost importance. Number four, reassurance through love and what? Emphasizing safety. Don't worry. This is good. The fact that a person has asked, or you said to your child that you have asked, it's great. Yes. You show that you care, but also demonstrate that they're safe. Don't show your anger because of this question. Number five, present a way in which the answer is understood in a simplified manner. Yes? Therefore, these are five tips. We come to the question that is quite challenging for people. This requires what? Your attention for a few moments, because there are some philosophical arguments presented to this so that we can understand it, but also later appreciate how we can present this to our children. Yes? When they ask us, who made God? Who created the Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's look at the philosophical answer for you and I before trying to present this simplified to their youngsters. In order to understand this question, we have to appreciate that it has an answer. There are some who believe that this question does not have an answer. Yes, it has an answer. Number one. Number two, we have to understand that as far as existence is concerned, there are of two types. There are those who are possible existence, mumkin al-wujud, and what? There is a necessary existent, wajib al-wujud. What is the difference? A possible existent has the following aspects. Number one, they are limited in terms of space and time. They are what? Limited as a being. Number two, they go through change. As Einstein says, there is this universal dynamic movement that what the universe is going through, yes? So they constantly go through change. That is what? A possible existent. Possible existent means they may or may not exist, yes? Number three, they are dependent on others. They require others. They are what? Relying on others. And number four, the other characteristic of a possible existent is that they are in need. They're constantly in need. Their needs need to be fulfilled. Yes? That is a possible existent. The necessary existent is what? Is not limited, number one. Does not go through any change, number two. Does not depend on anyone or anything, number three. And is not in need. He is absolute. That is the what? The necessary existent, wajib al-wujud. Now, there is this process known as the law of causation. Yes, the issue of sababiyya. The law of causation says what? The law of causation says every possible existent needs a cause to come into existence. Without this cause, it will not come to existence. Yes, every possible existent, which has these four particular aspects as we described, needs a cause. A cause is known as illa in philosophy, which means what? Something that brings it into existence. Yes? And if we now begin to think about this, every possible existent needs an existent. But if we trace this back, what? There will be infinite regress. There has to be a starting point. This is known as the first cause that brings about existence, yes? That first cause is existence. And that is the necessary existent. That is wajib al-wujud, yes? That necessary existent is existence. Because if that necessary existent needs something to bring it into existence, it's no longer the necessary existent. It is a possible. And if it's a possible, then we go back. And we go back and there is infinite regress, which logical mind rejects. Let's give examples. If there is a prisoner today who is waiting for the release has to come from a commander. The commander says that the decision has to come from another commander. And the other commander says the decision has to come from another commander. There has to be eventually a commander who gives the decision. Otherwise, they cannot go around what and say there. Decision lies with one particular commander, isn't it? And that is why the answer to this question is, God is existence. He is the necessary existent. He brings about existence. He is the source of existence, yes? He is not created. He brings about creation. And that is how we answer this question philosophically. Now you ask, but how on earth am I supposed to make this clear for my child who asks me, everything is made, therefore how is God made? We have to use the Quranic tool of using similitudes and parables. We have to simplify using examples. Yes, please pay attention to this so that you are able to deal with these difficult, tricky situations. When a child asks who made God, we say, tea that has sugar. If you're Iraqi, you say sugar that has tea in it. Yes. This particular drink that people have, how did it become sweet? Because of the sugar. Yes, you say to the child, how did it become sweet? Yes, I place sugar in it and it's become sweet. Yes. The sugar, how is it sweet? You ask the child. So I don't know. You say sugar in itself is sweet. In itself, it's sweet. Yes. Sugar, as far as the sugar canes, is in itself sweet. There is nothing that makes it sweet. It is sweetness. Yes? So there is nothing that makes it sweet except itself. Itself, it is sweet. Yes? Another example. This wall or any wall is white. How is it white? It's painted white. How is the paint white? In itself, it's white. Yes? It is originally white. So therefore, when we give these particular examples, what do we illustrate to the child? We begin to make the child understand that there is what? There is something which has the quality that it possesses from within its own self, that, from its essence. Yes? And then we say that God Himself is creation. God does not need to be created because He is creation. Yes? He brings about creation. Therefore, He is not created. Because just like how the sugar, yes, is in itself sweet, God in Himself is creation. And He gives creation and bestows creation upon whatever He likes. That's why when it comes to these stories, when it comes to these parables, it's of the utmost importance, isn't it? I remember a child once asking his grandfather, there is no point reciting the Quran in Arabic because I don't understand it. And so it's best for me to recite it in English. The grandfather said, very well. But you and I are going to go on a small trip. They went on a small trip. They lived in a hill together for a few days. Listen to this story and how an individual invests in time with their children. One day in the morning, the grandfather says, I want you to go and get me some water from the river, yes, down the hill. And I'm going to give you this bucket. The child goes, takes the bucket, goes down, comes to the river, fills the bucket, but then realizes the bucket is full of holes. Rushes back up. By the time he rushes back up and brings the bucket back, the water is drained. There is no water in the bucket. He's disappointed. He wonders why his grandfather has given him a bucket full of holes. Next morning, the grandfather says the same thing. I want you to go and get me water. The child objects, says, please do it for me. The child goes, realizes it's the same bucket, the same thing happens. The third day, when the grandfather asks, the child says, you have to tell me what's going on. The grandfather says, on the first day, when I gave you this bucket, it was dirty. You went, you filled it up, it became cleaner. The next day, you did the same, it became even cleaner, yes? Despite you not bringing me the water, look at the bucket in itself. Now it's much cleaner than it was. The child says, yes, and so what? He says, your heart is like this bucket. You recite the Quran, you may not understand it, but it cleanses your heart. This is how we should be what? Communicating with our children. That's why when it came to Amir al-Mu'mineen wa Imam al-Muttaqeen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, he would speak to his beloved daughter, Sayyida Zainab, yes? And what? And she would say to him as a question, she would say to him, father, do you love me? And he would say, yes, I love you. She would say, do you love Allah? Yes, I love Allah. She would say, but father, how can a heart love two things at the same time? Look at the response of Mawla. He says to her, my dear daughter, I love you because I love Allah. Allah has commanded me to love you as a child of mine. Yes. Hence, you come to this magnificent household which teaches you and I the principles of successful parenting. Because I tell you today, parents need help. Parents need support. There are important recommendations that we have to give from the minbar. Which is what? Let us have courses, let us have workshops, let us have people with experience, with tools, offering this support to parents. Some of them are struggling, some of them are going through difficult times, dealing with their children, with what? Behavior of their children, with certain aspects of their children. And one of the best ways is to look at the exemplary parents that were Ali and Fatima, peace and blessings be upon them, isn't it? We all have heard this wonderful story in which the Holy Second Imam says, I saw my mother praying, yes. I saw my beloved mother Fatima performing her salah, reciting, and uttering those words of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which salah is it? Salatul Layl. And this highlights how parents should make sure that their children watch them pray if they're not joining them. Yes. Allow them to be in that environment. Create the environment that is conducive for learning. And so the Imam alayhi salam asks his beloved mother, why is it that in your prayers I heard you pray for others? Yes, in your dua, in your supplication, Sayyidatul Nisa, the Lady of Light, would think about others, would supplicate for others. Yes. And so she would answer, isn't it? She does not dismiss the question. She did not say, why did you unnecessarily pose this question? She would give this beautiful answer to the Imam. She would say, Ya Bunay, oh my dear son, Al-Jar, Thumma Dar, the neighbor, then the house. Yes, we think about others before we think about ourselves. What a magnificent line that highlights the importance of upbringing and tarbiyah of our children to be what? Sacrificing and doing things for the sake of Allah in terms of acts of kindness. Thinking about altruism, helping others, changing positively the lives of others. That is why when it comes to this holy lady, the separation from her was very painful and difficult for her children. The realization that she has left this world, only 18 years of age. I tell you, today we discuss questions, but there are questions related to Sayyida Fatima that even till today have not been answered. Why was she buried at night? Why did she say, I don't want certain individuals to attend my funeral? Why is it that this holy lady's grave is still hidden? Why did the Prophet of Islam say, her pleasure is the pleasure of Allah and her displeasure is the displeasure of Allah? Why did she die angry with certain individuals? These questions are important for the Muslim world today. Yes. And if our child asks us about these questions, we should not be dismissive. We should not be worried. We should explain the injustice that the Lady of Light went through in an appropriate manner. In a manner that is historical, that is academic, highlighting how she was treated, highlighting how her rights were usurped from her. Yes. That is why that night, bidding farewell to Sayyidatul Nisa Fatima, is arguably one of the most difficult nights for the children of Fatima, salamullahi alayha, Hassan and Hussein, Zainab and Umm Kulthum. The riwayah tells us that Amir al-Mu'mineen was washing the body of Sayyida with her clothes on, supported by Asma bint Umays. But there was a moment that Asma said, I have not seen my Mawla do ever in his life before. I saw him sit in the corner of the room. When he sat in the corner of the room, he had his head between his legs and he was weeping and crying. I said to him, Ya Ali, you are the one who dislodged the gates of Khaybar. Why do I see you heartbroken? Why do I see you weeping? He then raised his head, his face full of his tears, drenching where he was sitting. He said, Asma, whilst I was running the water on top of the clothed body of my wife Fatima, I felt the broken ribs. I felt the broken ribs. I would not be able to continue washing the body. Yes. The broken ribs of Sayyida breaks the heart of Fatima. Yes. Breaks the heart of Amir al-Mu'mineen, isn't it? That's why when he eventually finished the washing and the shrouding of the body, he called out, Oh Hassan, Oh Hussein, come and bid farewell, Oh Zainab, Oh Umm
Umm Kulthum, this is the wida', this is the final farewell. They came towards the body of their mother. Can you imagine that sight? This was the final time they would see their mother Fatima al-Zahra. The riwayah tells us that they threw their bodies onto the body of Fatima. They cried, Ummah Fatima, who will be for us after you? Who is it that's made us yateem? One after the other, they shed the tears. The riwayah tells us that Ali heard a cry from the heavens. There is one body on top of the body of his mother. Remove that child from the body of his mother. I wonder who is it? The malaika said, Oh Ali, take away Hussein from the body of Fatima. Why, oh why? Malaika cannot bear to see Hussein in this state. If the malaika could not bear to see Hussein on the body of Fatima, you all know where I'm going, huh? How did they bear to see that man sit on the chest of Hussein? Allahu Akbar, isn't it? Amir al-Mu'mineen takes the body with Ammar, with Aba Dhar, with Salman al-Muhammadi. It was time to bury the body of Sayyidatul Nisa, yes, in that hidden grave. When the burial took place, it was the moment for Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen to feel the grief. It was the moment for him to bid farewell, isn't it, towards his beloved wife, Sayyidatul Nisa. He sat there crying, he sat there mourning. Do you know what he did? The next thing he did, wallah, to the lover of Fatima, to the lover of Ali, the lover of Rasulullah, this is truly heart-wrenching. Amir al-Mu'mineen then turned towards the grave of his beloved prophet, his beloved brother Rasulullah. He then began to speak to Rasulullah. Listen to these words that Ali comes from the heart, addresses the prophet. He says, O Prophet of Allah, please accept my salam and that of your daughter who is being buried not far from you. Your daughter has come to you so quickly. O chosen messenger, the death of your daughter has left me without patience and solace. I have lost my self-restraint and the power of my endurance. After having endured the separation from you, I shall have to bear this catastrophe patiently. O Prophet of Allah, I laid you down in the grave with my own hands. Your soul departed from my body while you were resting upon my chest, and your held head was lying between my neck and heart. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Then he says, your trust, your daughter, which was entrusted to me, is now taken back. Sorrow now abides with me, and happiness has taken leave. I no longer have happiness. Then he says, this grief is so overbearing that it engulfs me. It swallows all the other sorrows. It has left me with sleepless nights and joyless days. From now onwards, my life will be a continued heartache until God gathers me with you both in the realm of his favor and peace. O Apostle of God, your dear daughter will tell you how your followers have behaved with her, how they mistreated her. Yes. Then he says, please, both of you, accept my salam and goodbye. It is the farewell that Amir al-Mu'mineen says to whom? To his beloved, to the Holy Prophet. Then he says to him, what? He says to him, O daughter of Rasulullah, may you rest in peace with your beloved father, Rasulullah. He then says, if I leave your grave to go, it's not because I am tired of your company. Rather, I wish I had it till the end of my life. If I make a permanent abode on your grave, it will not be because I doubt the reward that God has reserved for those who bear sorrow patiently. But farewell, O daughter of Rasulullah, and peace and blessings be upon you both. At that moment, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen was shedding the tears. He fell asleep on the grave of Sayyidaha. When he fell asleep on the grave of Sayyidah, he saw his beloved wife in the dream. She said to him, Abul Hassan, thank you for reciting the Quran next to my grave, for being next to me. But there is one thing I ask you to do. What is it that Fatima wants from Ali in that night of the burial? She says, my daughter Zainab has just woken up in the house. She is asking, where is my mother Fatima? Allahu Akbar. Oh, Abul Hassan, please attend towards my daughter Zainab. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen wakes up. He goes back to attend to his daughter Zainab. Allah, we say to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, if you had to rush back from the grave of Fatima to see your beloved daughter Zainab, ensuring that she does not shed a tear, come to Karbala and see what Zainab had to see. Allahu Akbar. Because Fatima to Zahra, yes, she was present in Karbala in so many instances. She was present in Karbala when Ali al-Akbar was breathing his last, and he saw Fatima, didn't he? When Imam al-Hussein said to him, why are you smiling and why are you grieving? He says, I'm smiling because I saw Rasulullah. He has quenched my thirst, but I'm grieving, oh father, because I see Fatima slapping her cheeks, saying, wa Husayna. Yes, and on that night, Shama Ghariban, I leave you with this. Sayyida Zainab, that difficult night with the suffering of Ali Muhammad, that difficult night, she falls asleep those moments. She begins to see that one child of Imam al-Hussein is missing. She goes out on the plains of Karbala. She looks right and left for that child, for that yatim. Eventually, she finds a lady fully covered with that yatim, with that child of Imam. She approaches that lady. The lady is what? Is not visible. So Sayyida says to her, may Allah reward you. You have protected yatimatul Hussein, isn't it? That lady raises her head. She looks at Zainab and says, oh, my daughter, this is your mother, Fatima al-Zahra. Zainab cries, Fatima, my mother, I'm sorry. If only you saw what I saw on the day of Ashura. Mother Fatima, I saw the bodies of Aun and Muhammad return. Mother Fatima, the head of Qasim was split into two. Mother Fatima, the eyes of Abbas was pierced by an arrow. Mother Fatima, I had to hold the body of the 6-month-old Ali and Al-Asghar. I saw the arrow in his throat. I had to console his mother. Mother Fatima, don't blame me, because I don't want you to see what I saw. Mother Fatima, I saw that man sit on the chest of Hussein. I saw that man stab Aba Abdullah. I saw that man hold the beard of Hussein.
ألا لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين وإنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise us with Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Ya Allah, accept our a'mal and our aza in honor of the Lady of Light, Sayyida Fatima. Ya Allah, we ask you to bestow upon all the parents and all those parents to be the rahmah, the tawfiq, the light in their hearts to be the best parents in your path. Ya Allah, we ask you to grant us tawfiq to visit the shrines of Ahl al-Bayt in dunya, to learn from their lives and to attain their shafa'ah on the day of Qiyamah. Ya Allah, allow us to see the graves of Jannatul Baqi' rebuilt once again, and allow us to hold majalis and honor the Ahl al-Bayt, inshaAllah. مأتم حسين يا حسين.
حسين.